Morning, church. I'm trading my sorrows. I'm trading my shame. I'm laying them down. The joy of the Lord. I'm trading my sickness. I'm trading my pain. I'm laying them down. The joy of the Lord. I'm pressed but not crushed. Persecuted, not abandoned. Struck down but not destroyed. I am blessed beyond the curse, for his promise will endure. His joy is gonna be my strength. Though the sorrow may last for the night, the joy comes in the morning. I'm trading my sorrows. I'm trading my shame. I'm laying them down. The joy of the Lord. I'm trading my sickness. I'm trading my pain. I'm laying them down. The joy of the Lord.
Sing yes, Lord.
Sing yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Yes, yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Yes, yes, Lord. Yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, yes, Lord, amen.
Amen.
Yeah, the guitar kind of gave up on me, but that's okay.
My soul, my soul, my soul must sing. Beautiful tasted and seen of your great love, and you satisfy me, you satisfy me, Spirit. Tasted and seen of your great love. Show me your glory. Show me your glory. Spirit, fall. Open up heaven's door. We're waiting worship for more. You're the only love that satisfies me. Lord, we run into your loving arms. We're safe and secure in your love. You're the only love that satisfies me. Leave me astounded, leave me amazed. Show us your glory, the heaven invade. We're waiting with worship, we're waiting with praise for the almighty presence of God to invade. Mercy never fails me. All my days have been held in your hand. From the moment I wake up till I lay my head, I will sing of the goodness of. my life you have been faithful. All my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, I will sing of the goodness of God. And I love your voice. You have led me through the fire, the darkest night. You are close like no other. I've known you as a father. I've known you as a friend. And I live in the goodness of God. All my life you have been faithful. My life, you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, I will sing of the goodness of God. I will sing of the goodness of God. I will sing of the goodness of God. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. With my life laid down, I surrender all. I give you everything. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. My life laid down, I surrender all. I give you everything. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. And all my life you have been faithful. My life, you have been so, so good. Every breath that I am able, and I will sing of the goodness of God. I will sing of the goodness of God.
My Lift your hands to heaven this morning and just worship Almighty God. Father, you are so worthy. You are so worthy of worship. The songs we've sung this morning have declared how beautiful you are, how wonderful you are, how we exalt you this morning before the heavens. And Father, we just want to lift up our voice to you this morning and just declare that you are Lord of Lords and King of Kings, and you are worthy this morning to be worshiped. You are worthy this morning that we should bow down before you and acknowledge that you are Almighty God. Hallelujah, hallelujah. We worship you, Jesus. We worship you, Jesus. Church, on the way to service this morning, I heard on the radio, there's two ways that you can look at life. And they're speaking as a parent to a child, and then they said you can either prepare the road for the child, or you can prepare the child for the road. And I thought, wow, that's talking about kids, but really that's talking about us and our spiritual journey. We can try to prepare the road before us. We can try to orchestrate things in our life so that we go the way that we want to go, but there are times when we just need to prepare ourselves and say, Father God, where do you want to take me? Where do you want me to go? I'm ready. I'm preparing myself. I'm desiring to straighten my life and to organize myself that I would honor you, and that as the path goes before me, it may not be what I expect it to be. There may be some turns and some bumps and some hills and some valleys, but God, it's the road that you've prepared for me, and I'm prepared to walk it. So church, just as we worship God this morning, would you just acknowledge wherever you are in your life right now, some things may be going your way, some things may not be going your way. You may be stressed, you may be worried, and you may be feeling great. Whatever stage of life, whatever part in life that you're in right now, just prepare yourself. Search your heart, search your spirit, and say, okay, am I ready for the road that God has for me? Am I willing to walk that road? A few weeks ago, Pastor talked about taking up your cross and following. That's it. That's what we need to do. Take up our cross and follow. But we need to be prepared. We need to be ready. We need to be in His Word. We need to be worshiping. We need to be praying. We need to be in communion with the person of God that we know, in a relationship with Him, so that when those bumps and hurdles come, we're ready. And we know that He is faithful. And we know that He's been there yesterday, today, and forever. So church, that's the kind of God I worship this morning. I don't know about you, but if that's the case, then just give Him a praise this morning. Hallelujah.
To bow down. Here I am to say that you're my God. We're all together lovely, all together worthy, and all together wonderful to me. Here I am to worship. Here I am to bow down. Here I am to say, together loving, all together worthy, all together wonderful to me.
Hallelujah. Thank you. Well, church, that was just for free this morning. That's just what God laid on my heart, and I just felt I needed to share that with you. So welcome. You may take a seat. We're so glad that you are joining us here today. If you're a guest in the house, welcome. And hopefully you had a chance to chat with some of our greeters coming in so that you know the protocols here, how to follow in and out and around, and what we're doing to sanitize and stay healthy here in Kingston. If you're joining us online, we welcome you this morning as well, and we're glad that you're here to join us. So there's a few announcements that I need to bring to your attention. I heard yesterday the men had a nice gathering out in the parking lot there with their coffee, and I heard some good conversation and some good laughs together, so that's always a great time. And ladies, we have not forgotten you. You're joining us this week on Tuesday night. We're going to Robin Shock's house on Tuesday evening at 6:30. If you're not sure where that is, just talk to either Robin or myself, and we can give you directions. There should have been an email that you received as well. If you're not getting those, let us know. But there should have been an email that was sent out in regards to where that address is. And please remember to bring a lawn chair with you and some sort of beverage. It is going to be a chilly night, so perhaps even a little blankie to wrap up in, maybe, because we are staying outside just to keep socially distanced and safe. So come join us, 6:30 at Robin's house. Deeper Life is Wednesday night at 7 o'clock, starting back up again, and it's exciting times. I know that you guys really enjoy getting together, and we thank Dan and Wendy for heading that up. Missions Committee is Tuesday the 22nd at 6:30. And we have our first youth night coming up on September the 25th at 7 o'clock. We're going to be meeting here, and we're going to be figuring out kind of how we do youth now in this new day and age. And so come join us that evening on Friday the 25th at 7 o'clock. We have a board meeting that is coming up on the 28th. Wow, this church is busy. We have a board meeting coming up on the 28th at 6:30 for those of you that that affects. And as well, I just wanted to thank you guys again for your continued giving. I know the Missions Committee has said it. I know that Pastor has said it from the pulpit a few times, that just giving has continued and that there has been no downturn in our finances. Our church has continued to do well, has continued to move forward, and continue to meet our missions goals and things that we have set out as well for this year. So, you know, God is on the move regardless of whatever else is happening. And if there's a chance for you to give this morning, if you are joining us online, there's an online box icon there on the website that you can give there. If you want to drop it off in the mailbox outside, that is checked throughout the week as well, the black mailbox outside the doors. And of course, if you want to drop it into the office, there's office hours here as well. Giving in-house, there's a box at the back exit doors on your way out. Some of you are familiar that have been coming for a few weeks. Just drop it in there and that'll be collected afterwards. But other than that, that's it for our giving, and I'm just going to turn it over to Pastor Steve.
The light's on. Oh, good morning, everybody. Glad you're here today. We're seeing some faces we haven't seen in a while. We've seen some brand new people. We just want to welcome you here to City Christian Center, and we're glad you joined us online. According to the KFLNA, I can take this off. Don't be jealous. Oh, yeah, now I'm stuck now that I bragged about it. One second.
That's right. I deserved that, didn't I?
You get what you asked for, don't you? We are really so glad that you're here, and one of the reasons I had Cheryl do announcements so that you don't hear my voice as much. That's why I had someone else lead worship, and on the five-string guitar, no less. Nice job. What do you do when a string breaks? You pray, and you keep on going, right? We're so glad you're worshiping the Lord in the house today, because we believe worship has the power to overcome. Spiritual forces has the power to overcome our mental state, our emotional position, even our physicality. I've seen someone play over someone in worship, and they were healed. I couldn't believe it. But God is a good God, and there's some amazing things that have been taking place. And so I'm going to jump right into the Word today. Last week I talked about the desert of decision, and we talked about the Israelites being, making their way through there and deciding whether you're going to have a good attitude or a bad attitude. And I thought I was going to move forward, and the Lord said, hold on a second. Not only are we not going to move forward, I'm actually backing up a little bit. We're still in Exodus 15, but right to the point where Moses and the Israelites had come out of the Red Sea. He split the Red Sea. The Lord split the Red Sea, and they said they walked across on dry land. And then after they were on the other side, of course, the ocean, the sea came back, and destroyed Pharaoh and his army who were pursuing God's people and trying to destroy them. So when the Lord says back up, you know what you do, right? You back up. And thankfully, well, I don't know, sometimes I get it, sometimes I don't. But more often than not, I'm hearing the Lord and I'm like, okay, I've learned not to try and do it my own way and then have to fix it again, but to say, okay, Lord, you want to stay here? We'll stay here. To some, you might think, I just took the same message and just, you know, stuck with it so that I didn't have to work. Because, I mean, we only work one Sunday of the month, any of the week anyways, right, as a pastor. So today, actually, is still the desert. There might be a whole series coming out of here. I don't know about the desert, but this morning's called The Desert of Song and Dance. And you maybe have heard the phrase, don't give me that song and dance. It refers to someone telling a story, but more like a fish story, where, you know, we've decided to embellish some of the details about the story, and usually it's someone in authority who watches a kid trying to get away with something, and it's on their face. They can just tell. My mom could always tell when I was stretching a story. She'd look right at me, and I'd be like, man, I am so busted, because I just, she knows. Yeah. My mom's in the audience. She's like, amen, brother. She could just tell. And so someone would say, don't give me that song and dance, right? But in fact, this morning, I'm going to switch things a little bit. I'm actually going to encourage you to get your song and your dance. You're supposed to wait to partway through the service to get all emotional and everything, but we need our song and dance. And there's a lot of things that steal our song and dance. But today, we're taking it back. Amen? Amen. It takes some practice. It takes a choice. That you need to remind yourself at times, count your blessings, name them one by one. I mentioned that last week, right? But then sing about them, dance about them, take a look at the goodness of God, and own those things that you can take hold of, because it's important. The Lord has instructed me literally to remember my song and dance. And I've told you before, my dance would be a little ugly up here. It would scare some of you, right? But we all need to have a song and dance. And so the narrative in Exodus 15 includes the people singing and dancing when they realized what they had just come out of. Have you ever had a near miss, like you're alive today, but you don't know why? Like you missed it by that much and the car just went and just somehow missed you? Or you were about to fall off somewhere and someone caught you, you got your balance and you didn't fall over the bridge or off a cliff or whatever? Or, I don't know, about a month ago I was using a circuit saw and I almost lost a finger, but I didn't. Whew. Things happen, and for whatever reason, well, I know the reason. I think you do too, but for whatever reason, it's a near miss, and afterwards you go, whew, just like all of a sudden there's this release of the adrenaline and everything. You realize what almost happened but didn't. I need us to get there sometimes, just go, wow, you know, if it hadn't been for Jesus, whew, one of those close, almost bought it. That was it, almost. You know, pushing up daisies, whatever, just that was the end. And yet, because I recognize that God took care of something, there's a sense of relief and wonder that, wow, he took care of it. And part of doing that is by praising the Lord. So the Israelites had just come out of, first of all, they're a little blown away because they walked away from captivity. And they didn't just escape captivity. It says on the way out of their captivity from the Egyptians, after all those plagues, it said that they actually plundered the people, their neighbors. Are like, hey, nice necklace. Do you need that? Can I take that? Thank you. Yeah. How about that? And they were just taking things from the Egyptians who just wanted them out of there because the fear of the Lord had overtaken them. After all of those plagues, finally the last one of the death of the firstborn of every person in Egypt, Pharaoh just said, get out, go, leave. And they're like, okay, sure, come. Can I have your lunchbox? You know, like they just took whatever and left. As if they were a conquering army. The Lord so blessed them. They didn't just escape. They were delivered. And they were delivered from bondage and slavery. They were delivered with all kinds of means to carry on. And yet they get a little bit down the road and all of a sudden they are confronted by the Red Sea. Another immovable obstacle. Another way that we can't press on. And then God says, take your staff, put it in the waters, and boom. The sea opens up, and the entire nation walks across. It says, on dry ground. It says it, so I believe it. And then on the other side, Pharaoh's army goes, what have we done? We just lost our whole workforce. We're going to have to go robotics. We have no more manual laborers. And so they send their army after them and say, we got to capture them and bring them back. But by then, of course, it was too late. Even though the Israelites saw it and they were afraid, God delivered them, and the army pursues them into the ocean, and it covers them up and destroys them. And Moses is the singer, Miriam's the dancer, and they're all declaring this worship back and forth. They're dancing, they're singing, they're celebrating. They just missed near death. And they're like, wow, and this is what comes forward in Exodus 15. There's actually a picture I have up here, and it's actually a picture, and the background is part of a mural from the Messianic Society Cemetery in Jerusalem. And this is someone that painted the depiction of Exodus 15 as they interpreted it. It's quite beautiful. And so they're at that point where they just come through and go, whew, we just got delivered from unbelievable situation. And so I'm going to read this chapter really quickly, but I want you to get the parts where it says singing and sang and declared and dancing. And so you've heard this song before. It's actually turned into a hymn that's really hard to sing, but so I won't try and sing it this morning. But it says, then Moses and the children of Israel sang this song to the Lord and spoke, saying, I will sing to the Lord, for he has triumphed gloriously. The horse and the rider fell into the sea. The Lord is my strength and song, and he has become my salvation. He's my God, and I will praise him. My father's God, and I will exalt him. The Lord is a man of war. The Lord is his name. Pharaoh's chariots and his army, he is cast into the sea. His chosen captains also are drowned in the Red Sea. The depths have covered them. They sank to the bottom like a stone. Your right hand, O Lord, has become glorious in power. Your right hand, O Lord, has dashed the enemy in pieces. And in the greatness of your excellence, you have overthrown those who rose against you. You sent forth your wrath. It consumed them like stubble. And in the blast of your nostrils, the waters were gathered together. The floods stood upright like a heap. And on it goes. It's like a hymn with five verses. You know, the old Psalms that some of them actually had six and seven verses, if you can imagine. And I'm not speaking against hymns. There's some great doctrine in those hymns. But also some of them were just like, well, it's like Pentecostal choruses. We sing them seven times, but it's the same thing, but they would sing it seven times, and it'd be a different thing. And you'd have to understand. I'm like, I'm trying to track with what they're telling us. And now on the other side, people are like, you know, choruses are so simple. It's like, okay, we get it. We get it. I'll come back to that a little later. But on and on, Moses and the people are singing and speaking. So if you're not a singer, that's okay. Just talk it out. Maybe there were rappers back then. I have no idea. They're just all talking about the goodness of what God did there. And then coming down to verse 19 again, it's like a recap, like a repeat. It says, for the horse of Pharaoh went with his chariots and his horsemen into the sea, and the Lord brought back the waters of the sea upon them. But the children of Israel went on dry land in the midst of the sea. And then Moses' sister Miriam, the song of Miriam says, Miriam the prophetess, the sister of Aaron, took the timbrel in her hand, and all the women went out after her with timbrels and with dances. And Miriam answered them, sing to the Lord, for he has triumphed gloriously. The horse and its rider has been thrown into the sea. They still had to cross the desert. They still had to defeat new enemies. The future was not going to be easy. But in that moment, they recognized the goodness of God. And instead of hurrying into the next problem, which we're all prone to do, they worshiped. They worshiped. They found their song. They found their dance. They took the time to step into that. Even though they had more stuff to deal with, they had just come through miraculous things. They'd been delivered, and they recognized it. Even though they were prone to complaining, like only the Israelites are, ha ha, me included. Even though they know they followed their own wisdom and fear sometimes, it got in the way of what God wanted for them. Even though they had a problem with authority at times, talk about arguing with Moses and grumbling and complaining. Even though they struggled, they chose to worship. Sing and dance in the desert. You know, I don't think the actual song matters. There used to be a war in the churches over hymns versus choruses and what style and what not style. And at one church, did you know in the old times, an organ, which most people have said, it ain't worship unless it's got an organ in the church. You know, initially the organ was used in bars. Oops. And then brought into the church. Do you know that most of the melodies that those first hymns were written of were actually bar songs, but with Christian words to them? You're singing a bar song. Yes, but I'm glorifying Jesus. Thank you very much. I was at a church once where they had red drums, and someone was joking about those darn drums. They're red. They must be of the devil. And we kind of, and they were kind of joking, kind of serious, and I was like, actually, they're covered by the blood of Jesus, and that's why they're red. So, you know, it's, and my son's a drummer. He's like, yeah. Yeah, anyway, sing and dance in the day. It doesn't matter what kind of song. It doesn't matter what kind of dance. If you're a toe tapper, that counts. Okay, if you're a boogie or that, you know, whatever. Square dance, I don't know, the river thing, you know. Whatever you do, you do you. But what it comes from inside, okay, is that spirit of joy, that spirit of choosing. I'm going to sing and I'm going to dance. Like David danced before the Lord and he said, listen, I'll be even more undignified than this. I might look like a goof jumping around here in my undergarment and whatever. It says he had a linen ephod on. So you can imagine what that was like, you know, trying to do a backspin or whatever. It's inside. What begins to happen in our spirit comes out in song and dance. But sometimes we have to wait for something to hit us before we're going to sing and dance. Well, I'm just not feeling it yet. Well, let me tell you something. You won't. You won't just feel like singing sometimes. You won't feel like just dancing sometimes. And there was a moment in the midst of their struggle where the Israelites just said, excuse me, I'm about to get my groove on, but in Hebrew, of course, but the same words. They decided that they were going to worship God in that moment because they had just been delivered from something great, even though they still had stuff to deal with. Find your song, find your dance, and don't let it get stolen. T.D. Jakes spoke a few weeks ago about women dancing in this very verse. He reminds us, no matter what desert you may be going through, keep your dance. Don't lose your dance. Don't lose your song. I say dance on purpose and sing on purpose and praise him. There's an old chorus, and here's where we get to those Pentecostal repetitive things. The words go, praise him, praise him. Praise him in the morning, praise him in the noontime. Praise him, praise him, praise him when the sun goes down. The key words being, praise him. It's actually a good foot stomper, you know, if you want to get yee-haw and the whole bit. It's a great tune, but the purpose of it is just, it's not supposed to be difficult. You're not supposed to go, you know what, I'll sing that when I've heard it about five more times, then maybe I can get it and get into it. Yeah. No, if you don't got it right away, praise him, praise him. Praise him in the morning, praise him in the noontime. Praise him, praise him. Praise him when the sun goes down. We're Pentecostals, so sing it again. Ready? Praise him. Praise him. Praise him in the morning. Praise him in the noontime. Praise him. Praise him. Praise him when the sun goes down. There you go. Did you know that song? By the end of it, you knew that song, right? And that's the thing with worship, even with some of the songs I write. I'm like, here's the new song, but by the way, it's really easy. That's the point. It should be something you can get a hold of so that you can worship. And some of those old hymns were theological wonders in themselves. And you could learn so much, but also you're only engaged up here going, wow, that's so deep. But you're not just singing from your heart. And then some of these new songs, they've got a really cool beat, but if you don't know it, it's kind of hard to find out where you're supposed to be singing. The whole goal in corporate worship is for corporate worship, for us to come together and be able to get hold of something like that song. And you need to choose to worship God no matter what. Last week I spoke about the decision to allow your natural circumstances dictate your attitude, your mindset, your emotions, or to have faith. And God would not let me go that this week. So here we are again, a little different, but the same idea. It's important to recognize how to do that. So I want to take you to Jeremiah 31, 10 to 13. The really simple three things I'm going to tell you from this portion, but I'm going to read these verses first. It says, hear the word of the Lord, O nations, and declare it in the isles afar off, and say, he who scattered Israel will gather them and keep them as a shepherd does his flock. For the Lord has redeemed Jacob and ransomed him from the hand of the one stronger than he is. First part, so listen. Listen. Jeremiah 31, by the way, took place in 1948 when Israel was once again declared a nation. Hundreds of years later, the word of the Lord rings true. And the first word is hear the word. So listen. Verse 12, therefore they shall come and sing in the height of Zion, streaming with the goodness of the Lord, for wheat and new wine and oil, for the young of the flock and the herd. Their souls shall be like a well-watered garden, and they shall sorrow no more at all. Number two, so sing. You don't have to be a good singer. The Bible says, make a joyful noise. I'm singing! Not everyone who stands up and says, I think I have a gift from the Lord, or I have a song from the Lord. You know, some of those people, God gave them a song. They should keep it, right? Now, it was for them. That's all I'm saying. It's maybe not for the multitudes. But we are required to worship because God made us. And in his awe and wonder, as soon as you recognize who God is, man, there is awe and wonder. There is inspiration to recognize how great our God is. So it says, so listen and so sing. And then verse 13, then the virgin shall rejoice in the dance, and the young man and the old together. For I will turn their mourning to joy and will comfort them and make them rejoice rather than sorrow. So dance. Listen to the word, sing and dance. Now watch how the word of God is full of exhortation to use praise in ministry. I'm going to look at Psalm 71, 1 to 24. Don't worry, I've already run a bunch of chunks of scripture. I'm going to just point out some words in this passage, okay? David gets the importance of praise. It says, my praise shall be continually of you. And throughout this portion, it says, let my mouth be filled with your praise. And will praise you yet more and more. And again, my mouth shall tell of your righteousness. I will make mention of your righteousness. So if you're not a singer, just mention stuff. And to this day, I declare your wondrous works. You can just say it. Until I declare your strength to this generation. Also with the lute, I will praise you. It's a stringed instrument. No, the lute was a flute, sorry. The harp and the lute. And to you, I will sing with the harp. There it is. And my lips shall greatly rejoice. And my tongue also shall talk of your righteousness all day long. We're going to verbalize our connection to the Most High God. We need to make noise in honor of God. As Pentecostals, we believe in the presence of the Holy Spirit, active and moving today, because some people think he was great back in the day. He was, but he's the same yesterday, today, and forever. And while his presence is always here, we ask for the manifest presence. And I'll tell you why. When you ask Jesus into your heart, really, it's a deposit of the Spirit in you. He's there. So for us to say, oh, Holy Spirit, please show up like he hasn't been here, that's not theologically what we're actually asking. What we're saying is, Holy Spirit, we know you're indwell. We pray for the filling. We pray for your manifest presence, where signs and wonders accompany the word, where we see miracles taking place, where God is moving in this place, and we can tell. You can't see the wind, but last night I heard the effects of the wind. You cannot see the Spirit, but when his manifest presence shows up, it's Shekinah glory. People have said they've seen a cloud. Sometimes they've seen a wind. Sometimes they've felt that still small voice. They felt the presence like a blanket just being, you know, when you pull a blanket out, and then it just goes. People describe it in as many natural ways as they can, but it's something that's supernatural, and what we're talking about is his manifest or tangible, feelable presence, and we believe that happens. In other words, the effectual presence, the presence that's recognizable, I'm glad I put that in there, it's powerful. He's working in ways that we can experience. The Holy Spirit convinced you of the gospel in the first place. If you believe in Jesus, guess what? Thank you, Holy Spirit, right? If you have recognized the truth in God's word, thank you, Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit gives power and peace and gifts and allows fruit to grow. The Holy Spirit helps us with our faith. When we step into Spirit-filled or anointed worship, it affects our faith. It alters our spiritual person and ultimately our whole person. When you feel like a song, you won't feel like a song and dance until you start doing it. I was talking to the men yesterday about what it is to be a man, what it is to be a God follower, a believer, and a man in this day and age, and what we're supposed to present. And so many times there's this image of a man like don't cry and suck it up and be a man. And I brought them to Isaiah 61:3 that says, put on the garment of praise for the spirit of heaviness. So when heaviness comes, it wasn't a revelation to me, but the Lord reminded me of there. It's heaviness is a spirit. In John 10, it says the devil is only on earth for these purposes, to kill, steal, and destroy. So when we feel that heaviness is a spirit, and so what does he give us? The garment of praise. Now, I don't have a worship jacket on, but what he's saying is you cloak yourself with worship. You sing, you pray, you read, you dance. You do whatever you do is unto the Lord. That's worship. And when you worship, you've got this garment of praise on you, and it changes the atmosphere. It changes your mindset. It changes how you feel. It changes in your spirit first, and then it manifests. You begin to feel it. You begin to notice the difference. So I want to talk about the power of praise for just a minute, because, and I had about three different lists. I've narrowed it down to just one. It's not exhaustive, but I want you to recognize that praise, first of all, brings glory to God. Praise brings glory to God. You worship God, you exalt Him, people know about it. Even if you're only reminding yourself, praise brings glory to God. Praise pushes back the darkness, because with the presence of God, there can be no darkness. They can't cohabitate together. Jesus talked about that when people accused the Pharisees, accused Jesus of doing miracles in the power of Beelzebub. He's like, How can a house divided against itself stand? He was proving that what he was doing was in the light of Jesus Christ, not in the darkness of the devil. But praise pushes back the darkness. Praise removes the spirit of heaviness, and that we read in Isaiah. Praise brings peace, the peace that passes all understanding. So it surpasses our mind that worries, our mind that has lists, our mind that has excuses for all the reasons why things aren't going to work out and why I can't succeed and why things aren't going to work out and why things always fail and why I'm about just two steps away from something broken. I've told you about my brother before. Sometimes I've said, how are things going? He's like, oh, pretty good. I don't know. I'm like, what do you mean you don't know? He's like, well, they've been going so good for so long. He's like, I know something's going to happen soon. So it's like, no, dude, you're going to be okay. But praise changes that. Praise brings peace beyond what we think might come next. And all of us, if you're on social media for more than 10 minutes, you heard me last week, first of all, stop it. Check your messages and then get out, okay? If you read just one news thing, either if you're going to do news, then listen, do news. But don't go, yeah, this is my favorite news, the only news and whatever news. I told you about the things that work, the algorithms with things like Facebook and Instagram. Once you start liking or looking at something, it keeps sending you those things. So if you're a little left wing, you become, a left wing eagle. And if you're a little bit right, you know, it's just one turn and all of a sudden you're like, woo, and you're all the way down to the extremes, because the extremes get a reaction. The extremes are newsworthy. The extremes are what people are talking about. And I've decided that I want to be extremely in the center of God's will. I want to be extremely calm in the light of all the junk that's happening around me. I want to be extremely full of faith when there's all kinds of worry. But it's a choice. And so how to do that? I'll tell you, I've had days where I don't feel like that. I go down the trail, I watch stuff, and I'm like, man, the world's going to end, or wow, we're overreacting, or wow, we're underreacting, or we're overspending, or what is the government doing, and what's happening down south? Don't even go down that. Don't even say that. Just, you know, like, there's so many things. What's happening around the world? Let's look at the list of everybody who's got sickness, and we dwell on sickness, and we dwell on fear, and we dwell on death, and we dwell on war, and hey, what's happening with the latest storm, and where was the last earthquake, and oh my goodness. They're real things. I'm not sticking my head in the sand. But in the middle of that, I can just dwell on those things and let them begin to weigh on my spirit. Or I can say, okay, I've read all that now. Just give me a second. And get to singing and dancing. It's a mindset. You got to say, wait a second. I haven't sung and danced yet today. Try that Monday morning before your first cup of coffee. I haven't sung and danced yet today. We need not to let the world steal our song and dance. And I know that sounds just funny and light, but I'll tell you what, it's the best medicine. And I practiced it on myself. this last week, a couple of days, I had a bit of a stomach thing for 2 days, and I'm like, oh, corona, oh no. And I start worrying about, oh, no, I'm going to affect everybody I've been in contact with, and I'm going to hurt somebody, you know, like my wife's in the school system, I'm going to, you know, pass that along there, and I got people at the church, I'm going to pass that along there, and my mind went down the road, all the roads. I'm feeling sick, I'm feeling, you know, fatigued, I'm feeling stressed, and man, I had to get myself praising. I had to get myself to, first of all, go, okay, well, you're not dying, hold on, right? Your tummy's a little upset, relax. You know, man colds, right, ladies, right? Just big suck on the couch, right? So half I got an amen, and the other ones I was just like, we don't talk about that. I just had to realize, I had to connect with God and say, you know what, I'm just going to thank you, God, for what I have, who I am in Christ, what the Word says. And, you know, within just a little over 24 hours, it went on like the second day. That's what started getting me thinking. Kept a low profile, just relaxed. You know what? God brought me through it. So either I was really sick and a miracle took place, or the miracle was in my mind where God just said, hey, let this mind be in you, which is also in Christ. Just may peace be with you. Just hold on, relax, rest, do what you're supposed to. I was telling you a list, wasn't I? Sorry. I'm just saying the power of singing and dancing, the power of praise can lift us and move us in ways that we don't often take advantage of, believer. And it's there for you and me today. Today. Praise brings glory to God. Praise pushes back the darkness. Praise removes the spirit of heaviness. It brings peace beyond understanding. Praise shares faith with yourself, with other people around you. Praise heals people. And I've seen it. I don't have time to go down that road, but praise heals. You know, I had a lady who was talking to me about being bothered with, this is a different story. It's not the one I'm not sharing. This is the other one I am sharing. This lady was plagued by spirits in her home. Doors would close. Things would drop off shelves. People would say, oh, that's haunted. I'm like, well, that could be a supernatural thing. That could be a spiritual oppression or something. Because in Ephesians 6, it talks about rulers and principalities. Demons have certain places where they try to operate. You just have to say, mm-mm. Where I'm standing is holy ground. This is my house. It belongs to the Lord, and I just claim it in Jesus' name. Get lost. And I've done spiritual house cleaning with some people. We start at the basement and work our way up. What I'm saying is she would begin. I said, listen, I can't get there till I forget it was a week later. I got to come and pray with you in your house. But start playing praise and worship music. And right before she played music, she'd said, you know, I go downstairs. It's with a half split. When I go downstairs towards that ghetto blaster, that's an old cassette tape, never mind. It's how she played music. And she said, as I went downstairs, it seemed darker. And I don't mean like there were less lights on. It was like it was a film, like a fog. And to get to that place where she pushed play, it was like a struggle. And as soon as she pushed play, it was like a candle just began to lighten up the place. And all of a sudden, things began to change because praise pushes back the darkness. Praise builds faith, and praise heals. So that's even praising in a supernatural sense. Began to heal her mind, began to give her peace. Praise can be evangelistic. We don't have the volume up that loud, and the windows aren't open, but you know, when I travel overseas, most of the places we're doing pastors' conferences and worship services and stuff, the windows are open. There might be some bars on them so people can't get in, but there's no glass, there's nothing. And typically overseas, when you do a worship service or a teaching, they usually turn it up to about 11, and then they bring the special guests right up to where the speaker is. They're like, here, you stand up at the front with us, and then worship's like, woo, right there, and you thank God for it. And then you go, huh, out of the other ear. It goes out into the community. I remember one year when we were in Trinidad, we did an outreach, and it was at the back of some convenience store. We had one plug. And it was raining out, and we had a few umbrellas and a little kind of dining tent thing. And that became our sanctuary. And people on the team went through the town that afternoon with a tiny little flyer just saying, hey, we want to invite you to service tonight. We're going to have some music and praying. And it rained that afternoon. It was nasty, messy, whatever. But just one microphone and a little guitar and some bongos and out in the middle of this tiny little town. There weren't even any street lights. Like, it was dark. And I think they had the light from the variety store at the back kind of shining so you could kind of see people. But we just had church.
And it was just amazing. People just out of nowhere came together, and they began to praise and worship. And this tiny, dark little back corner parking lot became a worship center where God was delivering people and strengthening them. People came to the altar, and they were praying and crying, and the Lord was doing work. It was evangelistic. And I'll tell you, everyone in that town, it was a small enough town, and of course, you remember, they're at 11, right? Turned up to 11. And so the whole, I don't care if they came to church or not, they had church that night, okay? Just in their living room, they had church. In their dining room, probably in their bedroom. Hey, keep it down. We're having church. It was good. Praise can be evangelistic. Praise can teach doctrine. And that's why it's evangelistic, because the word of truth goes out and it does not return void. So praise teaches doctrine. Praise builds spiritual intimacy. If you don't know how to praise, if you don't know how connected you are to God or not, begin to praise Him. And then you're going to start to become familiar with this idea of talking to God on a regular basis. You don't know how to pray? Sing. Dance. You don't know what to say? Well, sing the words of the song. Now, there are a few hymns that are a little erroneous or off. And there are some choruses, definitely some that are way off. Someone took exception once to this old chorus. Let's just praise the Lord. And they're like, what do you mean just praise the Lord? You're praising the Lord Almighty God. You can't just say just. And you're right. You know what? You're right. It shouldn't be approached glibly or casually like, oh, whatever. But if you look at those words and say, I'm going to take the rest of the world and shut it out. And let's just praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. All of a sudden, it's different. You begin to worship and it builds intimacy with you and Father God. Praise dethrones ourself. You worry about what you look like singing or dancing? Great, get over yourself. Right? And nothing better than to just start dancing and go, man, I must look ridiculous, but I'm praising the Lord, so it's okay. It is okay. But what you have to do in order to get to that place, especially you conservative Canadians, me too, is to get over yourself and just enter into praise and worship. Enter into singing and dancing. Because it breaks stuff. It breaks yokes of bondage. Whether it's pride or fear or whatever else it is, man, you start doing that, it's kind of hard to be like this when you're doing this. Try to get your eyebrows down. And look mad, but keep just boogieing to the Lord and singing His praise. See how long that face lasts. The sourness just soaks out of you. I'm sorry, it can't happen. Because praise changes things. Where am I? Praise brings glory to God. It pushes back the darkness. It removes heaviness. It brings peace. It shares faith. It heals. It can be evangelistic. It teaches doctrine. It builds spiritual intimacy. It dethrones our flesh. Praise informs the next generation, right? Jesus loves me, this I know, for the Bible tells me so. That's teaching doctrine. It's helping little kids get it. Adults need the same word. Praise gives us purpose. What are you on this earth for? To praise the living God. That's your job. Praise makes room for the Spirit of God to manifest and to activate promises and release power. So my challenge for you is to start with praise and worship, thanksgiving and exaltation for the Lord your God, and watch the transformation in your spirit, in your emotions, in your thinking, and in your present reality. Put on the garment of praise for the spirit of heaviness. It's okay, he can worship wherever he wants. That's all right. We love the little kids. We're so glad they're here. I want to challenge you, because whatever week you've had, if it's been a great week, then you've got lots to sing and dance about. If you haven't had a great week, then let me challenge you to start by singing and dancing. Start by singing and dancing. Start by putting on the garment of praise. See, no one just gets dressed. They don't just wake up and their clothes just jump on them, right? There's this, you know, I put my pants on one leg at a time, just like everybody else, right? It's something that you put on. So there's an intentional element to it that you and I need, and this week I'm challenging you to intentionally make sure that whatever else you're wearing this week, you're wearing a garment of praise. You won't let the devil take your song and your dance. You will not let it go. No matter what desert you're walking through, you'll hold on. You'll hold on. So we're going to sing a great old hymn in a second. I'm going to invite the worship team out just in a second. But I want to pray for you this morning, because I know that there are things that keep us from our song and dance. And we could go down that road and try to put Band-Aids on everything this morning. But that would be contrary to the word I just gave. Because you may need to do that. You may need to get some more healing. You may need to walk through something or talk through it with somebody you trust. If you need to talk to someone, you can always call the office or get in touch with me. We can put you in touch with either myself or somebody who can even just listen and hear what you're going through. Okay? There's a need for that. But also, let me challenge you right now, before anything else happens, the very first thing you should be doing is finding your song and your dance. Asking God to restore your song and your dance. So I don't know what's kept you from that, but this morning we're going to pray for God. This is what I love about God. He doesn't often pull us out of things, but He's faithful to always pull us through them. So if you're trying to get through something right now, we're just going to invite the Holy Spirit to reach in and just scoop you up. And as you begin to praise, to sing and dance, He's going to pull you through that stuff to the next level, to that next place where you begin to see over all that stuff and see what God is still doing in your life, all right? You understand what I'm saying? You agree with me? How many of that have you sound like, think that's a good idea? Sounds good, doesn't it? Yeah, I need it, so hallelujah. Praise the Lord. So you're in this desert of song and dance. You get a little sand between your toes. It's probably warmer than whatever's out there at the moment. But I want to pray. So let's just take a moment. We're just going to make this a prayer room for a moment. And we're just going to begin to pray. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Praise you, God. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. So there's something we can do when we're in the corporate presence here. The scripture talks about where two or more are gathered, and we can bind and loose. And often I pray, and everyone comes up and gets prayer from one person. But I just want us all to agree right now. And I want you to try something with me, because while you may be looking for your song and dance, there are some people in this room that are still looking for their song and dance. They're looking for that joy again. They're looking to step over some stuff today. And while you might be in that place too right now, I'm going to get you to add your faith to praying for the people on the right of you right now. The people on the right, you're going to pray for them right now with me as we lift them up. Father, we ask for the joy of the Lord to be our strength. We ask for the garment of praise. And there's more than enough garments to go around this morning. So we pray for the people right beside us on our right. Lord, Holy Spirit, I pray you'd minister to them. And the words you give us by your Holy Spirit right now, whether it's tongues or an exhortation, whatever, we just, right now in our minds, between you and me, Lord, spirit to spirit, we're asking you to minister to that person on their right-hand side. You would restore their song. You would restore their dance. You would help them see that you are so much greater than what we're dealing with right now. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. And now we shift our faith for a second. We're going to think about the person on our left right now. You know how many people are praying for you right now? It's awesome. No one's going to sit on the outside ever again. You can pray for across the sanctuary, okay? That works. We pray for the people on our left right now in Jesus' name. Holy Spirit, you're faithful. You're faithful. And when your children ask for whatever it is, healing, a touch, peace, joy, strength, hope, God, you're faithful. So we pray for the person on our left right now who needs their song, who needs to dance again, who haven't danced in years, that things have held them down. And while they've had faith, they've also had their struggles. And today, you want to break that yoke and begin to fill them with the joy of the Lord that will help them sing again. Put a song in their heart and put a dance on their feet, Lord God. Set them free right now in Jesus' name. Now, Lord, I thank you for the privilege I have, because you've been bugging me all week. You've been doing this for me. And so I pray for every person within the sound of my voice in this room, and I pray for every person in the live stream right now who are watching this message, they would get their praise on. But, Lord, to get to that place right now, Holy Spirit, I ask that you begin to move in a profound way. It doesn't have to make sense in your mind. It doesn't have to feel like it in your heart or your emotions right now. Because we're inviting Holy Spirit to begin to do that work in your spirit. Holy Spirit, work in the spirits of these people who need whatever they need to get to their song and dance right now, Lord. And God, I ask that you will manifest your presence in them to overcome what they're dealing with, to see past it, to recognize who you are, God, and what you're able to do, and begin to deliver them, begin to restore them, begin to remind them of what you've brought them through already. They've come through the Red Sea on dry ground. They're not in slavery anymore. That bondage has been broken. And he who the Son sets free is still free indeed. And help them recognize that right now, that your goal is freedom. Your goal is faith. Your goal is to move them through what they're dealing with, to get their song and to get their dance. God, I pray for every person, including myself, that when I let the flesh, when I get natural things get in my way, Lord, remind me like you did this week. Remind all of us. I don't care if you've been a Christian a day, a week, or decades. We need that perspective, Lord. So restore that in us, that we're going to put the garment of praise on this week. And you will minister to us as we step in to praising you, to singing and dancing before the Lord. We do that first. Then we see your spirit inhabit the praise of your people. Then we see you move. Then things change in the heavenlies and in our natural circumstances. We love you, God. And we ask and thank you for these things in Jesus' precious name. Amen. 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 Let's sing this last song. Thank you, brother. You can stand or sit, kneel, whatever you want to do, but let's give the Lord praise.
Great is thy faithfulness, O God, my Father. There is no shadow of turning with thee. Thou changest not thy compassions, they fail not. As thou hast been, thou forever. Thank you.
ask that you would put a song in our hearts. It might be this one, it may be a different one. But that, Lord, we would recognize that we are going to put on the garment of praise. We're taking our song back. We're taking our dance back. And we're going to do it as unto you, Lord, no matter what it looks like, no matter what it sounds like. We are going to exalt the living God. We're going to give you praise, Father. We're going to worship you, Jesus. And we thank you, Holy Spirit. You are who make the difference, Lord. You who offer us hope and life. We thank you, Lord. Help us rejoice in you. In Jesus' name, amen. Just before you go, my challenge is for you to continue to praise. I know I've said it over and over again. The Lord brought just the first two lines of this song in my spirit. And I thought, you know, you may not remember partway through verse 2 or partway through verse 3, but the words were, "Great is thy faithfulness, O God my Father. There's no shadow of turning with thee." And it went over and over my spirit, like, you know, a good Pentecostal. I'm like, I know, I get it, I heard it, I've heard it. But the Lord continued to use that word. So whatever that word you begin to sing, whatever you begin to move in the spirit, I want you to recognize it can be simple. It can be unintelligible to anyone else on the planet, but just you and God. You just communicate it to the Lord, and he will usher you into that place where he can minister to you, and you can commune with him. So church, go for it. Get your praise on and worship the living God, all right? God bless you all. Have a great day.